events I witnessed as a young boy in Carnation, Texas, back in October 1918. Only a handful of people still living know what happened there. The memory of it has gradually disappeared, like the town itself. Fields gone fallow, husks of abandoned barns fallen in on themselves. Years ago, I swore a sacred oath never to tell what happened. I had let my memories, like the town, become overrun with weeds. However, recent events have forced me to break that promise, for reasons that will become clear. A writer named Bulgakov once said that manuscripts don't burn. By that, I think he meant that some stories can't be silenced, even if you hide them in a box in the attic or toss them on a bonfire. They have a way of being told. And there are so many stories haunting me from that fall, so many years ago. Many voices still whisper in my ear. So with a trembling hand, I'll describe the events as I witnessed them. I won't leave anything out. My fear and my regret at not being able to save the ones I loved, except for the location of the town. For no one must ever go back to Incarnation and risk provoking the malignant forces that cost us so dearly. I don't know if telling the story is the right thing to do. I just know I have no choice. May God have mercy on my soul. I've been sickly since birth, and a burden has fallen on my mother. While the other boys run and play, I stay inside my hut. I lie on the dirt floor and look up at the ceiling or through the small gaps in the mud walls. My world is composed of bits and pieces of that larger world Mother tells me about. Through the gaps of it, I see fragments of the sun and sky. I glimpse an ankle from a villager running by. The blur of a stone kicked by children's legs, agile and strong. More than these fragments of images, my world is composed of sounds. Women pounding out roots, whispering to each other, the crackling of early morning fires, grunts of men stringing bows, sinew and wood tightening, slaps on arms and legs to warm themselves, getting ready for the hunt, and the cry of the itself, marking its territory with wheels and turns, high in the heavens, and far away the haunting sound of the nokas, calling with their big cat calls to each other in the hills. I do not go outside into the light, because the dust sickens me even more than the smoke from the fire inside. I cast no shadow. Sometimes I wonder if I could ever cast one. I have a constant companion just the same. Not one of light or darkness, but one of sound. It's the sound of my own breath, gurgling and spitting. I have always had it. I'm so used to it that if they found some magic way to remove the fluid that constantly fills my lungs, I wouldn't know what to do. It would feel like a death in the family. Today when I awoke, I heard no more sounds of the replacement men, or the villagers, or the children. No groans, no hacking coughs, no lamentations, prayers, or curses. Today, when I awoke, I heard only the rustling of the trees. By midday, the animals lost their apprehensiveness. They began their scratching and calling and entered the village common area. They became bolder still, and I could hear them licking the pots for leftover food. Soon, over the sound of buzzing flies, I heard their growling and yelping as they began to fight over the corpses. If I could only lift my body up and crawl to the entrance of the hut, something I've never been able to do, I'm sure I would see the grass growing tall in the common area, the corpses strewn here and there, skeletons gnawed clean, still dressed in rags, the shiny stones and dolls, the ball made of leather straps, the wooden pestle for pounding roots. All of them are still and untouched, showing the first signs of rot. My mother's love for me had been so strong, so consuming, she had succeeded in killing each and every living person in the village, original or replacement. As I turned to her corpse, I kissed her sweet-smelling hair and said, "Thank you." streaming down my face. I thought of how many men were surrounding me. I thought of the heat. I thought of the day my mother sent me away on the train, the smell of the ham and cheese sandwich she'd packed me, and how a big kid had stolen it from me. I thought of my old man back in town, and his foul words and his foul breath, and all the times he'd ever punished me. The leader took a bone knife from his belt and took a step towards the man. I squeezed the trigger.
Stones glinted. technology will bring enlightenment. Fools, the only constant in this world is blackness of the human heart. Listen and be horrified.
It was hate that could never be mollified. It was innocence.
We stood around the grave, the simple headstone read, "Adoring Mother." It had stopped raining. There was frost on the grass, and the sun was bright and cold. I glanced down at my grandfather's pocket watch. The second hand slowly swept towards 11 o'clock. As we stood, not a word between us, a peal of bells from the church back in town rang through the air. It was as if all the suffering during those years were compressed into those simple notes. It was an ache that knew no depths. Just 3 nights ago, she turned to me, her eyes bloodshot, her body drenched in sweat, and she whispered that she'd seen the Muladona in her dreams. I told her it was only a fever, that we'd killed the beast together, but she refused to believe me. With a haunted look in her eyes, she said, "It's coming for us. Before it gets here, you gotta write down the story. You gotta tell everything that's happened." Since then, I've been writing furiously. I broke my sacred promise, but I must tell this story in case the Muladona does come, so you know how to defeat it. Don't listen to its lies. Trust in the people you love, and always do what you feel in your heart. I don't know if the Muladona is really coming for us or not. I just know I'm no longer afraid of it, or death, or any other thing the devil has in store for me. Years ago, we took a stand. We fought for everything that has value. Love, happiness, freedom. And we won. Every day since then has